My name is Tom Ulrich. I'm the Associate Director for Science Communications here at the Broad Institute. And it's my pleasure to welcome all of you and everybody watching on YouTube to tonight's talk in the Broad of 15 talk series. The Broad Institute came into being in 2004, and since then we've seen amazing progress in many fields of biology and medicine. These talks are intended to celebrate that amazing pace of scientific progress and talk a little bit about the ways that the Broad community has contributed to that. It's my honor to introduce our speakers for tonight, Stacey Gabriel, Danielle Ciofani, and Puneet Batra. Stacey is an institute scientist and the senior director of our genomics platform. Danielle is the senior director of our data sciences platform. And Puneet is a particle physicist turned data scientist and associate director for machine learning in the data sciences platform. Together, they will talk about the evolution of sequencing technologies since 2004, what's been accomplished as a result, and how computer science thinking and technology have evolved so that scientists can make sense of the huge amounts of data that have been generated in that time. Just a couple of notes. If you have any questions after their talk, either raise your hand for a mic runner or text your questions to a phone number that will be on the screen. If you're online and watching on YouTube, you can also send in your questions by YouTube chat. And if you happen to be tweeting tonight, we just ask that you please use the hashtag BroadAt15. And without any further ado, Stacey, sure. Take it away.
Hi, everybody. Let me echo Tom's sentiments and welcome you here to the Broad. So I'm going to get started. And I'll first say that it would be really impossible to tell you the story of the Broad Institute without talking about DNA sequencing. Indeed, our center contributed about 30% of the sequence to the Human Genome Project. This is a photo of our lab around the year 2000 as it appeared in the Genome publication. Now, the product of the Human Genome Project was a reference genome. You can consider this sort of the baseline. It's a single pass through those 3 billion A, G, C's, and T's which make up your genome. The project took 13 years, was the effort of an international consortium, and cost over $3 billion. Now, there's a whole lecture that certainly could be given on the completion of that first genome. But what I want to do is really focus on what's happened in the past 15 years, because that's the period that we're celebrating right now. Okay, so as of 2004, when the Broad was launched, we considered the human genome to be sequenced. That is, we knew that reference, that first pass through. And though the New Yorker sort of made fun of our excitement about this, we really were excited. And we knew that we actually had a lot to do and a lot to think about. And the advance over the past 15 years has been staggering. So I showed up on the scene in around 1999 at the Whitehead Center for Genome Research, right after I finished my PhD in human genetics. My work involved finding genes for a rare disease called Hirschsprung disease, which is a disorder of innervation of the gut. So we did a lot of work in the Mennonites of Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. Populations like the Mennonites really lend themselves to a simpler path to gene finding, owing to the relatedness and the small population size. So given these features, we could depend on the pretty low resolution approaches available at the time, namely these marker maps that were spread wide across for the genome, because remember, we didn't have one then. And we could use those marker maps to find segments that traveled along with the disease in these families. We were ultimately successful, but it took a very long time. Graduate student careers. So with the completion of the Genome Project and now sort of a glimpse at how the technology was changing in this period, I kind of knew this was the right place to be. To do that next step of saying, you know, of asking this question of, can the differences and commonalities of all of our genomes help us find genes for more common diseases? So let's talk a little bit about finding those differences between our genomes for a few starter facts. So your genome's about 3 billion letters, as I said. This encodes the tens of thousands of genes that make you. About 20 million of those letters differ between me and you. About 60 of those letters differ between you and your mom and dad, so they're just new for you. It's really important that we're finding these DNA variants over time, and I should say we find them by continually layering on new genomes over that first reference, first thousands and eventually millions. Finding these variants is important because they can be the sort of guideposts to help us find regions of the genome that might have a disease gene, but also because they might be causative. They might be the variant in the gene that contributes to that disease. And keep in mind, and from this slide, these big numbers, 3 billion bases, 20 million variants. And I'm going to tell you about finding genes for common diseases at the end. And common diseases mean there's a lot of people and a lot of variability, so we have to do massive studies to sort of, you know, make sort of a dent in any of this. So that's why we're excited about some of the scale of these technologies. So as I promised, I'm going to talk about DNA sequencing. This is a highly conceptual view of what DNA sequencing is. Basically, we're reading out letters, and we're recording the order of them, and ultimately, we're going to compare them to a reference. I'll talk way more about this technology in a bit. But before we get there, I sort of want to frame for you some of what's been so exciting in the past 15 years. So as I said, in 2004, when the Broad was launched, we had one human genome sequence. Now, just from our lab alone, we've completed over 172,000 human genome sequences, roughly the populations of Cambridge and Brookline. And there's probably a couple million complete genomes completed worldwide now. I looked up, because you know, we know the sequencers got a lot faster. So I looked up how many bases did our center, one of the largest in the world, produce in the year 2004 when we were launched. So we produced 40 billion AGCs and Ts. Well, how long does that take us now? Right now, it takes about 2 minutes. So that's pretty good, right? And of course, the cost of the data has dropped massively. So here I'm showing you the cost of a human genome versus time. So if you would have come to me in 2004 and said, hey, how much would it cost to sequence that next genome? The answer would have been $20 million. Today, it's a little under 1,000. And if you buy in bulk, we can do a little bit better. We often compare this precipitous drop in sequencing cost to something called Moore's Law. Moore's Law is this observation that the power and capacity of computers doubles about every 18 months or so. And so you can see we're beating Moore's Law by quite a bit. There's a way to, so I thought, you know, how could we further contextualize this? So here's a way. The iPhone that you're holding in your hand right now has about 100,000-fold more compute power than the computer that got the Apollo 11 to the moon. And that took 48 years. The sequencers in our lab right now run 268,000-fold faster than they did 15 years ago. So all of this is going on here in Kendall Square. You're right there. Oh, I have a pointer. You're right there on this red dot. And our lab's about two blocks away, sort of on the edge of Kendall Square, at the corner of Charles Street and 6th Street. This is what our building looked like in 1953. It was a Budweiser warehouse and manufacturing facility warehouse. It continued to be a Budweiser site into the 80s and 90s, and eventually it became our building. And so that's what it looks like now, not that different. And it still basically runs like a factory, but it's producing genomes, not beer. And so it's the same building we've had the whole time where the genome was sequenced, and now where we sequence a new genome about every 8 minutes. So I want to tell you now a little bit about how that technology changed because I've told you how impressive it is. So I'm going to start with telling you how the old way worked very quickly. So the old way of sequencing was called Sanger sequencing. In this old method, it was sort of clunky, so we had to get the DNA cloned or inserted into a piece of bacteria, every piece of DNA we wanted to sequence. We then used the bacteria to sort of make copies of that DNA so that we could eventually sequence it. Then the sequencing reaction happened, in which we built these extension products that represented that fragment. The extension products each ended with a different colored base, which represented what that base was, because there's four colors, four bases. We then loaded it into this thing here. I found one, believe it or not. It's a capillary instrument. The capillaries are allowing the fragments to run through. The small guys go faster than the big guys. And at the end, we're recording the colors, and the colors correspond to the sequence. Now, the new way, sequencing became massively parallel with the new way. And there were some really key innovations there, as you might imagine. So one of them was that we still had pieces of DNA we wanted to sequence, but we were able to stick these little pieces of adapter sequence, or fake DNA, to the ends of those fragments. Those pieces, those adapters, allowed the DNA to be stuck onto this. This is called a flow cell. It's kind of like a glass slide. Once the DNA got stuck, it could then be amplified right there on the flow cell. And billions of them could be amplified at once instead of, this was 96. Once they were amplified, many copies made, I should say, the sequencing could start, again, right on the same spot. And the sequencing's read out, again, in colors, but synthesis and analysis is happening simultaneously. This is a picture of what it looks like with the big microscope that's sort of recording this happening while the sequencing reaction is being read out. Now, we didn't invent the sequencers here at the Broad. This was invented by, this particular technology was invented by a company called Solexa, which was later acquired by Illumina, our current vendor, and they've done a tremendous job in advancing these machines. But what we did here was really develop sort of processes that were scalable and efficient and adaptable to the kind of science we wanted to do. So very briefly, we did things like borrow from the manufacturing industry. We did things like teach Six Sigma approaches to really teach the lab scale and efficiency and control. And we collaborated closely with MIT Sloan School in doing this. An example of that is implementing something called a pool system, which is a manufacturing technique, which basically creates the concept of flow and process throughout the lab. It sort of makes more predictability. After implementing this technique, which is, again, is applied in automotive and other types of industries, we really changed some of our key drivers of how we measure how we're doing. We shortened turnaround times. We could do it with less staff. We were using the machines more efficiently, so all this was a plus. And I'll tell you another one, and this isn't about process or work design. Here's a little bit of molecular biology that added to our efficiency. So the first thing to know is that only about 1% of that 3 billion bases actually makes part of, it makes a gene. It's coding. We call those bits that are actually producing the protein exons. Now, all of the exons together, we call the exome, not the genome. So think of it like that. The little colored dots are the exons. So we thought, what if we just wanted to sequence that 1%? Surely, you know, there's a lot of action in that 1%. It turns into the genes, the low-hanging fruit. Sure, the other parts are important. No offense to the other parts. But if we had to start somewhere, why not, you know, get started with a lot of these exomes? So we created a method, sort of a trick. So we took all that DNA and we put it into a test tube. Let's call that our pond of DNA. We then prepared the pond by chopping that DNA up and putting on those adapters I told you about earlier. Then we did something outside of the pond. We prepared what we call baits. So these are synthetic pieces of DNA that match to the sequence of those colored exons that I'm trying to eventually get. We throw the baits into the ponds. The baits have hooks on them, notice. They match up and they find their mates. And then eventually we go fishing. We're pulling out the exons away from the rest of the genome sequence. Believe it or not, that works. It works really well, actually. And by leaving behind all of that non-coding DNA, the 99%, we can sequence the exomes for about a quarter of the cost of a genome. And we've now sequenced well over 500,000 of them in support of a lot of these large studies that are performed here at the Broad. So what have we done sort of scientifically? What impact have these genomic methods made? I'll tell you just a couple examples. So I'll start off with rare disease. So there's a group here at the Broad, it's called the Center for Mendelian Disease Genetics, where we're looking for genes for rare disease. The group has sequenced DNA from 10,000 individuals, 5,000 families with rare disease affecting a variety of systems. In 30% of the cases, just following that simple exome sequencing, a gene for that disease was found. An explanation could be given to that family. Sometimes it was a gene that's already known, but previously the mutation had been missed, and sometimes it was a new gene. It doesn't escape me that had we had this exome technology back in the 90s, You know, I would have been out of grad school in like 3 days. But, you know, that didn't happen. But there's certainly more to do. There's more technology. There's still 70% to solve, and that, you know, is always going on. So in common disease, what I mentioned earlier we're so interested in, lots of progress, over 100,000 new gene regions associated to a host of common diseases like Alzheimer's, schizophrenia, heart disease. The important thing to point out here is a lot of these findings are new pathways, things you wouldn't have thought of as the usual suspects for these diseases. One of my favorite examples in common disease has to do with finding protective DNA variants. So a variant is protective when we find that it's occurring more often in healthy people than it is in sick people. This table I'm showing you 9 genes or 8 genes that had that effect, that there's some mutations in them that cause protection. I'm showing you the frequency of the mutation, so the mutation occurs in one in so many people, and the magnitude of the effect. The gene on the far left had been known, it had been discovered earlier by a group out of UT Southwestern led by Helen Hobbs, but the new genes were found from a very big exome sequencing project that we did here at the Broad. We sequenced 100,000 people, half with disease, half without, and these new genes have emerged. A couple things about them, they're really rare, so you have to sequence a lot of people to find them. They tend to be loss of function, which is interesting in many for many reasons. But one of the coolest things about it is that because they're loss of function and protective, they're really good therapeutic targets, because there's people walking around healthy with these genes knocked out that is affecting the disease. So one could imagine developing therapy for the sick people that would be, you know, not toxic, would be okay. And so many of these activities are underway. Cancer, we've done a lot of cancer sequencing with these genomic technologies. On the left, I wanted to point to some of these large survey projects that have been done. These projects, they call them atlases, where we're sequencing tumors and comparing the tumor to the person's blood, have been done in many cancer types. The notion is we want to sort of create a landscape of the different types of mutations that exist in different types of cancers. So we've completed now this project called the Cancer Genome Atlas, 30 different tumor types, 11,000 tumors in their matched blood sample. And we can confidently say from this that we know all the common cancer genes and tumors. There's about 400 of them right now. Now, a lot of these research projects, most of the research projects, are done with biopsy samples, which means you sort of depend on this invasive process and it's hard to get these samples. A new direction we're taking with collaborators in our cancer program here is this notion of blood biopsy, where one can take a simple tube of blood from a patient and decode the cancer genome. And that's because the tumors are shedding their DNA into the blood. And this has lots of research implications and also certainly clinical implications when you think about monitoring patients, you know, on therapy or after. And finally, something on a topic on everybody's mind, as Tom pointed to earlier, is infectious disease. So I'm borrowing a slide from Pardis Sabetti, who she presented in this venue last month. And I just want to point out, you know, some of the work that, you know, she's done, because these new sequencing technologies certainly impact the scale and the speed of these viral surveys to really help understand the evolution and spread of viruses. So I'm going to wrap up and say that, you know, the scientific examples I've given you over the past few slides have been efforts here at the Broad and efforts, you know, with collaborators all over the world. As the projects are gaining success, they're getting bigger. The data is getting much bigger. The number of participants is getting much bigger. And so we've kind of created a big data problem / challenge for ourselves. And that's what you're going to hear about next, our answer to that from Danielle. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for coming. All right, so Stacey talked to you about the fundamentals of the DNA sequencing technology, but there's a lot that needs to happen when data comes off the sequencer between that and actually extracting biological significance. So as Stacey mentioned, right, the data that comes off the sequencer is raw. There's lots of it, and it's really the unabridged recipe for your humanity, right? And to give you a sense of the scale of that data, that's about 200 gigabytes per human genome. Now, really, the next step of what you're trying to do is actually go from the raw data, lots of it, to actually extracting the variation, the things that are unique to you or the population that you're studying. And from the variation, then you can incorporate other data, such as what types of disease does this population have? Then you can start to explore correlation and statistics. But you can imagine in a world where the cost of sequencing is going down, every single human being on this planet could be whole genome sequenced. And it's actually a matter of reality at this point. So you're talking about 7.5 billion people times 200 gigabytes per person. That is on the order of exabytes, zettabytes, numbers of data that I don't actually even know how to build a mental model for. So this is clearly a big data challenge, and there's a clear opportunity for software to help. So I'm going to talk to you about kind of the middle path between raw data and biological significance, which Puneet will tell you about more. So in the early days, you know, geneticists were bought into the idea of software helping. It can standardize things and have fewer human hands and eyes on mechanically altering data. And so it makes a lot of sense that software development happened inside of the lab. And so the average research institute in the early 2000s really started dabbling in software themselves. And if you were lucky, you could hire a software engineer. But every research institute had software coming out of every kind of scientific lab focused on every different type of application. And this was a prolific era of software in genomics. There were many different recipes for analysis coming out of different scientific communities. But you could argue that it was actually possibly too prolific, because every team was working on solving every aspect of the challenge along the line. And you can imagine that really, scientists mostly care about the tail end of the process and not a lot of this upstream stuff. And so if everyone had their own unique recipe, it's kind of like reinventing like the chocolate chip cookie recipe. Everyone was building it from scratch. And you know, there's kind of a consistent way to get it right. Meanwhile, there's so much data coming online. So Stacey showed you the cost curve. When the cost curve decreases, there's a lot more ability to do more with the money that you have. And so we saw orders of magnitude difference from 2001, where we sequenced one human genome, to 10 years later, where we're bringing on thousands of patients at a time, to 2015, where we actually launched the All of Us Research Program, which is an American research project focused on recruiting 1 million participants. And actually, it's recruiting across the US, so if you're at all interested, you will get your whole genome sequenced, and you'll actually have a free genetic counselor session meeting. So if that feels like exponential growth, it's because it was and is. And so this is a chart from a 2015 journal called Big Data, Astronomical, or Genomical. And the, yeah, it's kind of cute, right? So the authors really assess the genomics field in the context of all other kind of big data players. So they looked at YouTube, Twitter, and the field of astronomy, and measured it against many different axes. And the TLDR, the too long didn't read version of that article, is that genomics is a beast. It's growing faster than anything. It's larger by default. It's heterogeneous. It's complicated, and you need to bring it all together to run really unprecedented scales of analysis. So it's a big one. And in 2015, this was the projected growth curve of the genomics industry. And really what this says is that the field, the amount of genomic data that we have in the world, is going to double every year. I can't think of many biological examples of things that double in size consistently every year in perpetuity. And to date, this projection has proved out. But what's even more interesting is the blue curve, which is actually Moore's law. So Stacey told you about Moore's law. And what it means is it's the accepted industry rate of how fast computer processing power will grow. And so the delta here is the important piece. Our ability to create data was outstripping our ability to analyze it. And researchers felt this on the front lines, especially in the early 2000s. So we had a lot of boutique tools and analysis mechanisms that were falling over when you tried to run them on larger and larger sample sets. Not to mention, the entire genomics field was actually running out of physical space to put the data. So if you've ever had, if you've ever tried to take a picture on your cell phone, and your phone tells you, like, I ain't storing no more photos, you're out of memory, right? You're out of storage. This phenomenon was happening to the industry writ large. Like, if the industry, the amount of data is doubling every 12 months, you can't buy servers and rent physical space fast enough to put the data in. So the infrastructure, really, we had a problem there. And you can imagine if it's hard to store data, it's probably hard to move it around and share and collaborate around it. And so we had what we called data siloing, where folks couldn't collaborate on common resources. And you can imagine if your code is falling over and it's pretty hard to get access to the data, you can say goodbye to reproducibility of your results, which is key to the entire community being able to build upon itself. And so the software community saw this, right? Researchers embedded in different scientific labs took a step back and said, maybe we should actually focus on bringing our boutique and kind of artisanal tools together. And rather than focusing on building every single one, why don't we bring them together into a toolkit? Why don't we collaborate and do that and build something that's got many different users and scientific communities in mind so we don't each have to do our own version of it? And why don't we pressure test it? Why don't we future-proof it against all the amounts of data that we know are coming out of this community? And let's try something interesting. Let's take a page from the consumer software playbook and actually hire dedicated support people to enable the community to use it. So from that, the GATK was born, the Genomics Analysis Toolkit. And through a lot of methods of trial and error, we settled on an open-sourced, free-to-use model for the rest of the community. And so in the historical world, if everyone was making their own chocolate chip cookie recipe from scratch, GATK is the Nestle Toll House chocolate chip cookie recipe, right? You could make your own cookie. Like, you could make a cookie recipe from scratch, but you could also, you know, use a low-effort way with 99.9% likelihood of your outcomes, right? And so the model has worked, right? Because it's been free, because it's been open sourced and available to the community and well supported, we've seen the international community kind of adopt GATK as the standard for how you go from that raw data to the variation. Now, what about all of the data, though, right? If we come back to the phone example, when your phone is out of storage, do you delete all the photos of everyone you love so you can make more room on your phone? No, you actually back it up to the cloud, right? In our world today, in the digital era, anytime you interact with the internet, anytime you put a product in your Amazon cart or stream something on Netflix, you're dealing with large amounts of big data that are on the cloud. And the reason it's fast is because many consumer platforms that exist in the industry today are leveraging the infinite scalability of all of this technology. But the genomics industry didn't really do that. And the genomics industry is young compared to a lot of these, especially compared to the internet age. But also the data that the genomics industry has been producing is the world's most sensitive data. It makes sense that you want to keep it close to the sequencers. And it makes sense that you want to keep it close to the researchers. But as I mentioned, we simply couldn't keep doing it. We couldn't keep buying servers to store the data over time. And so the migration of all of these kind of, you know, community resources of genomics data needed to move to the cloud. And we're talking hundreds of millions of gigabytes of data. And this has happened starting around 2010 and it's happening still to this day. But it'll require a lot of technology to kind of bridge the gap, both on security as well as enabling researchers to analyze. So if you're folks like software developers who make something like the GATK, and the goal of the GATK is to enable researchers to reproducibly analyze data wherever it lives, you got to enlist a lot of collaborators now. Now it's no longer the GATK developers who can do this. You're bringing along Intel to help optimize for Intel hardware. You're bringing along Microsoft and Amazon and Google Cloud to make sure that wherever the research data resides, researchers can guarantee the scientific output. So that's an example of like one place where the software community kind of got together, took a step back and said, why don't we focus not necessarily on scientific outcomes, but scientific enablement? And there are many other opportunities where software can help. So I'm just going to leave you with a couple of examples with an eye towards the future. So we can bring more patients to research and more researchers to patients. There are thousands of rare diseases out there in the world that affect not a large number of people, but are still devastating nonetheless. And when you want to study the genomic aspect of human disease, researchers launch a human subjects research study. And when you want to find patients to recruit, you usually work with medical centers, healthcare systems, hospitals. This model works really well if you're studying a disease that affects a large number of people. But when you're studying a disease where there's only 400 people in the world that have it, this model doesn't scale. Now, never mind, we're living in the digital era, where patient communities find one another through Twitter, through Facebook. And what's now possible is a direct connection between pre-existing patient communities and researchers. And what does that mean? Well, it means we're moving to a model of patient-partnered research, where patients are more informed, they are more connected, and they can actually start aggregating their own data together and be empowered about how they want to contribute to the research process. And where can technology help there, right? Well, technology first can connect across international boundaries for patient communities that are spread and distributed widely across the globe. But also, you can start to envision a model where you can help disease advocacy groups set up their own websites to start preemptively collecting data on patient populations and educating them about what it means to engage in research. And you can even imagine empowering patient advocacy groups to build their own websites through their own technology. So you can think of like a website builder specifically focused for patient communities. So there are 15 examples of this live today. And the results have been pretty transformational. But again, there are thousands of rare diseases that we need to tackle. But even today, hundreds of folks have ended their diagnostic journey with a diagnosis with a genetic disorder. In one case, a brand new disease that has never before been identified has been identified. And there are many people who have identified now treatment options that are on the market just because of the genomic signatures that we found through sequencing these patients. So that's the ability to sort of bring more patients to researchers. But what about bringing researchers to more data? So we talked about the movement of a lot of this genomic data to the cloud. But we have not yet updated the model whereby researchers get access to that data. Genomic data is the world's most sensitive data. And so it should be really tightly controlled in terms of how researchers get access to it. But unfortunately, today, that's still largely a paper-based system. So a researcher could apply for access. It could take weeks or months to even get access to the data. And even then, even if the data is living in the cloud today, still often the option for researcher access is for them to download it. And if there's anything that I've taught you, the data is too big to download. It cannot live on your laptops anymore. And so that model, again, this is an example of where when we take a step back and squint, we say this is an ecosystem-wide challenge that technology can actually solve. So what's possible? In a world where we have instantaneous access for many other things in our life and have come to expect it as consumers, there's a possibility where you can envision a world where you embed all that tight scrutiny of who's allowed to see the data, but you embed it into the web. You take it off of the paper-based system. And you can imagine a situation where rather than requiring someone to download a physical copy of the data, if it's on the cloud, why can't you analyze it where it lives? But it's going to take a village. And we've recognized that as a community. And in 2013, the Global Alliance for Genomics and Health was formed to bring together essentially the world to say, what does responsible data collaboration in the genomics and healthcare field look like? And what kind of technical standards can we come together around? And what kind of ethical standards can we define? And what does data security mean in a world where many times data cannot leave the physical boundary of a country, but potentially could you still enable scientific collaboration across boundaries? So I'll leave you with this. In today's world, we've got a number of consumer companies that exist that have replaced your need to physically store a bunch of information in your living room, right? Netflix has eliminated your DVD collection, at least in most cases. Right? No judgment if it hasn't. And similarly with Spotify, right? Many of us no longer need to store all of our CDs and albums because we can stream it, often at a lower cost. And similarly with YouTube, at least with YouTube TV, right? You no longer have to physically store copies of your favorite shows on your DVR, right? And even the DVR was an advancement recently. And all of this is accessible through the web for consumers instantaneously. we're moving towards this model in the genomics and healthcare fields, right? Where genomics data is living in the cloud, and really it's going to take a lot of different layers between the web and the technology to enable secure collaboration and analysis at unprecedented scales. But what kind of analysis, right? We haven't actually talked about what's enabled when you bring the world's most precious, but also the world's most kind of biggest and complicatedest data together. And what kind of biological meaning can you extract from bringing this unprecedented data together? That's what Puneet will tell you about next. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. So Stacey told us about the millions of genomes that we've learned to sequence, and Danielle told us about how we can make all of those genomes available to the world's community of scientists, and I want to make this really personal. I want to get this to the personal level. How do we take all of that data and talk about disease, which is a personal thing? Disease happens in people, not in aggregate statistics. And so we want to work on how do we understand how to diagnose, treat, and prevent disease. So this is my personal story. My parents are doctors, and it won't surprise anybody in this room to learn that when my mom learned that I wasn't going to medical school, I became a disappointment to her and still remain a disappointment to her. A few years ago, she called me, and she told me that my dad had hit his head. And usually, that's not a big problem, but my dad had had a stroke a few years before and was on anticoagulants, and that hitting of his head caused a brain bleed, which then caused him to be admitted to the hospital for a few weeks, and he had lost consciousness. Thanks to amazing medical care and emergency treatment, he came through that. But it was a scary few weeks, and at the end, what I wanted to know is there anything that we could have done about that? Is there anything that we could have learned in his history that would have prevented that sort of episode? And answering that question is really hard. It's part of our mission here at the Broad. It's why we brought this data together. It's why we're trying to analyze all this data at once. The challenge is that there's two different scales of data. On the one scale, we have data about people, which is very messy. It's very individual. It happens over the course of our lifetimes. It's unique to us. It's something that we experience and is hard to describe. And then we have the genomics data, which is there from birth and describes sort of our original situation, the original situation of our body and what we might be predisposed to. So how do we combine those two? It's actually not the only problem, how we combine that data. There's another problem. So this is a plot that goes by the name of E. Moore's Law. So we've heard about Moore's Law twice today, about the exponential growth of technology over the time and what that means and how that's difficult to deal with. The E. Room's Law, is Moore's Law backwards, and it describes the increasing exponential cost of developing new drugs. So over time, it has gotten exponentially harder, exponentially more costly to develop new drugs. And that's something we want to turn around. That's something we want to develop new tools to address. So enter machine learning, artificial intelligence. We've all seen these headlines, how artificial intelligence could transform medicine, machine learning to the rescue. This is one that came out last week on the bioarchive that I saw, a deep learning model to predict whether somebody has coronavirus from a chest CT. There's a lot of terms out there. Are these tools that can help us address these problems? Fundamentally, machine learning is a tool for finding new patterns in data. This is my son. He's learning to play baseball. And I want to give you an analogy for how we teach machines to learn in the same way that my son learns to hit a baseball. So he learns to hit a baseball by giving him lots of opportunities. He goes through a process of trial and error, which is the same way a lot of us learn things. Sometimes he swings and misses, sometimes he swings and hits, and over time he hopefully hits more often than he misses. And from that, he learns what it means to, he learns how to swing a bat at a baseball. That is distinct from sort of an algorithmic or rules-based approach. So in a rules-based approach, you might start with some data, maybe a list of numbers. You might start with some rules that you've gotten out of a book, maybe multiply all these numbers by 3. You apply those rules, and that gives you new answers on the data. So that's not how we would teach somebody to hit a baseball. We wouldn't give them a book and say, here you go, go out and learn to hit a baseball now. The machine learning approach is sort of turns this model on its head. We start with, trial and error. I'll get it right at some point. We start with data, and we start with outcomes or labels. This is the analog of going through a couple of trials and hitting a baseball properly or missing. Those are the outcomes we start with. Then we ask the machine to learn from that data and give us the rules. So we're not giving it the rules in the first place. We're asking for it to learn the rules from a set of trial and error experiences that it has exposure to. Then when it does that, I learned to hit go here. When it does that, we can take those rules and we can apply them to new data to give us new answers. So that's how we teach a machine to learn something and then get new answers out of that learning. So this is a trained model. It may show up in a second. Here we go. So this is pretty complicated, but this is a visualization of a trained neural net, which is one form of machine learning. So what you're seeing here is an input. So this is a model that's been trained to recognize digits, handwritten digits. This is one of the most common examples that are out there for people first trying to train models. And it gets an input number. That number is sort of broken apart into many small bits of information that get fed into a layer of the model. The model has then formed a lot of different patterns of connections across those bits into a second layer, which then proceeds into a third layer, and then into a fourth layer in this case, where the answer comes out. So that whole process of the model going through trial and error to learn what's going on ends up in a trained model. Then we can give it a new bit of information, and in this case, it can tell us what number that is. We can also apply that to clinical data, and it's being applied to clinical data. So this is an image from a cardiac MRI, which is one way of measuring the structure and function of your heart. We can ask physicians to label, in this case, the wall of the ventricle, one of the muscles of your heart, the muscle of your heart around the ventricle. And then we can send that into a machine learning algorithm and see if it can reproduce those labels at a much larger scale. And it does. We can take 10,000 or 100,000 trained labels and then have the machine learn the location of that muscle across many different aspects, across many different views of the heart. And this happens in other areas too. So this is a study that came out of Stanford in 2017. They gave 200,000 images of benign and malignant lesions to a neural network machine learning algorithm. And they asked it, and then those were labeled, and they asked the machine to learn what makes a lesion benign or malignant. And then they asked it to reproduce, to make predictions on 2,000 lesions that the machine hadn't seen before. They also asked the same question to 21 top dermatologists, Stanford quality dermatologists. The machine beat 20 out of 21 of them. This has been happening over more diseases and over more symptoms over the last 5 years. What started with a couple of areas, maybe even earlier than this, is now starting to extend beyond into different disease states, which is exciting. But it's still early days. There's a lot of interesting predictions in those models. But our question, as Danielle led to, is how do we turn this into biological function? How can we learn to diagnose, prevent, or treat disease from these algorithms? So to frame some of that, let me put this in the context of a story that Stacey told you about the discovery of PCSK9, one of the LDL-lowering drugs that are now in the market. So when creating a therapy, there's a couple of different steps. There's discovery. Is this caused by a variant on the genome? There's development. How do I put that into a clinical trial to validate that this drug that I have can actually make a difference? And then there's delivery. How does this get to the point of care? How do I know whether to prescribe this to a patient? In the example of PCSK9, which was serendipitously discovered as a protective variant, there's a new class of drugs called PCSK9 inhibitors. They're now on the market, tremendous success. It took 15 years to go from discovery to drug development. And at the end of the day, some of you may have had this conversation with your doctor. What should you do if you have high cholesterol? Maybe you should eat more salmon. Maybe you should take a salmon. Maybe you should take a statin. Or maybe one of these new inhibitors is right for you. How is this kind of machine learning, this new toolkit, being used to accelerate that discovery process? This is an example this is a project that's just started at the Broad and at the University of Toronto to see if we can use machine learning algorithms to accelerate the hunt for drugs that can cure disease, treat disease. The typical process of understanding, of figuring out whether a treatment can treat a disease is you start with a healthy cell line, figure out how to induce a mutation, for example, that can turn that healthy cell line into a disease cell line, apply treatments, and then see if that treatment turns the disease back into a healthy state. That takes a lot of grad students, a lot of time. It can take a lot of researchers, a lot of time. There's a manual component here, tool-aided, of actually trying to identify whether the disease has been reversed after the treatment. It can take multiple weeks in that case. So the Carpenter Lab here at the Broad has been working on tools that take technologies that can recognize faces, identify if this is me or you or my kids in a picture, and apply them to recognizing cells, how many cells there are. Are they clumped? What's their morphology? Has that changed over time? This is now being applied to that same problem before of finding a treatment, just at a much larger scale. Having that technology allows the groups to, instead of going through one disease, 1,000 drugs at a time, to go through 500 diseases, 500 cell lines, and 1,000 drugs at a time, which is a 500,000-fold increase in improvement. So this is a project that's just starting. It's an example of an exciting area where we hope that machine learning can make a difference. And it's also an example of how machine learning is a tool that we can apply to existing research endeavors to accelerate them. Another example, these are EKGs from two patients. These are electrical measurements of your heart. In one of these EKGs, the patient died within a year. In the other one, they did not. If you give this to two cardiologists, they won't be able to, they typically cannot tell which patient that is. What if we gave that to a machine learning algorithm and asked it to learn what the differences are between the patient who dies in a year and the one who doesn't? This is work coming out of Geisinger, and the trained model is compared against a cardiologist's read. So you give an EKG to a cardiologist, give that same EKG to the trained model, and let's look to see how these classifications correlate with five-year survival, so whether the patient is alive after 5 years. This is all retrospective. So in the case where both the model and the cardiologist agree that it's normal, there's a 96% probability of surviving to 5 years. Great. If the cardiologist thinks there's something abnormal, but the deep learning model thinks that it's normal, the five-year survival probability is 90%. if the model finds something abnormal, but the cardiologist says normal, the survival rate drops to 69%. And if both the model and the cardiologist agree that there's something abnormal, the probability drops to 57%. That's not great. What is it that the machine is learning from the EKG that the physician isn't seeing? So right now, these are done retrospectively on data sets. There's still a lot of open questions about how do we put this in practice? How do we identify exactly what it is that the algorithm is learning when it makes these calls? And that's a lot of what's ahead of us in the next few years, is figuring out the answer to those questions. Stacey and Danielle showed us that the amount of data we have over time is growing, and it's very exciting because this gives us a lot of new opportunities for discovery. There's another exciting aspect which is going on, where we're taking these large data sets of genomic information, and we're starting to connect that to large biobanks coming out of hospital systems. These hospital systems have individual information about how disease progresses in patients, which is what we need to connect the dots. And as we build more tools and discover how biological function relates between these two, at the end of the day, what we hope to be able to do is to get back to that personal moment where disease happens, to that personal, making this very personal, and understanding how disease progresses in an individual, and how we might be able to better treat, prevent, or diagnose that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Puneet. I'm going to invite Danielle and Stacey back up on stage for our question and answers. As I mentioned before, you can either raise your hand for a mic runner to come and bring a microphone to you, or you can text your question to the number that will shortly be up on the screen. Don't see anything yet. Yeah. But I guess I'll start off with a quick question for Stacey. I noticed that you brought up at the end how infectious disease researchers and experts are starting to use genomic data more and more and more as time has gone on, and as sequencing power has increased and speed and costs have gone down. So do you have a sense of what's going on right now? We're all very aware of coronavirus at this point. So do you have a sense of how the genomics community is contributing to figuring out what's going on with the coronavirus outbreak?
Definitely. So I guess for the first thing that I saw come out, and this didn't happen here, but I think it happened by researchers in China, was really how quickly the virus was sequenced for the first time. It was like some amazing land speed record from the first time it was recognized to really knowing the sequence of it, which I think obviously has led to the first turn of trying to develop the vaccines. And I know that's been incredibly impressive to the whole research community. I mean, there's lots going on, obviously, all over the place. There's stuff going on here at the Broad. Certainly with thinking about diagnostics, how to make diagnostics better and faster. This has already been published and I think released to the world already. And then we're also thinking about how to join the response to figure out ways we can study the virus and how it mutates and evolves and how to study the host and who's going to be infected, who's going to be protected. And so just many prongs of research right now into this really important area.
Question from the middle of the room down here. Yep, you're right there.
So the same question. I have a similar question to Stacey about the cost of genome sequencing. So you mentioned how the cost went down, and you also mentioned how the cost can go down by focusing on not the axons,
yep,
I think.
Just the axons. Yep.
So I'm not sure if you would know the answer to this. I'm sorry, but how would you say that the cost has gone down specifically because we have learned to not use to not focus on the axons, or is it just because of technological development? And if so, how maybe how did that happen?
So as all of the above, I would say in the example I gave you of the exome, yes, we selectively chose to sequence less of the genome, but you know, a very important part of the genome. So that's how we made that a lot cheaper. So right now we can sequence an exome for around $200. When we started doing it, it was a lot more expensive. But yes, the sequencing of the whole genome has also, as I said, come down tremendously, you know, sequencing all 3 billion base pairs in people. And that's really had to do with the technological advance of the instruments. And that gets faster in a few ways. The chips, I showed you these little chips, they've gotten a little bit bigger and they've gotten a little bit denser. So the spots are packed in there more tightly. The machines run a little faster. You know, so a lot of these companies have done a really good job in like pushing the limits of detection and you know what can happen on these slides. And so that's what will happen. And we're not done. I mean, there's been a goal of getting below $1,000 for a while, and we're there. But just last week at a conference, another company said it's going to be $100 by the end of the year. So we'll see. But that's a pretty exciting number, too.
I think I have about $70 in my wallet.
Oh, okay. That's in advance.
Yes, down here in the front.
Thank you. The examples that you gave for applications of machine learning in medicine were image-based. They were EKG signal-based. Do you have an example where the machine learning is directly applied to genomic data?
So I didn't show one of those. Didn't have nearly the time it would take to do that, nor am I exactly an expert in that application of machine learning. There are a couple of places where people are working on that. So Stacey mentioned earlier that there's a huge amount of extra data in the genome that we're not sequencing, this 99%, which is considered to be sometimes junk or regulatory. And so there's a lot of work going on to understand how those additional bits of data interact and change the expression of genes in the exome itself. So there's machine learning approaches to analyzing that.
May I ask a follow-up question?
Mm-hmm.
So the examples that you gave were also of trained machine learning, where you know the answer. The examples that you gave were of trained machine learning, where you know whether the patient died or not.
Yeah.
The example that you're giving for the DNA, would be untrained. You don't know the answer.
Yeah, unsupervised.
Unsupervised.
Yeah.
Is that creating additional complications? Is it working well?
So I didn't talk much about unsupervised. So that is, you're exactly right. That's the case where you don't have a label that you're applying, that you're asking the algorithm to learn from. There are techniques where you can give the algorithm a different set of relationships to optimize over where it can still find patterns, unsupervised ones. In the case of expression, they can, and this is something Aviv Regev will talk about at the next time, you can start to look at how genes are expressed differentially in cells and use that as ways of training some of your models. And then there are, of course, also approaches to just going in and seeing what patterns exist even without that information. So I think all of those are being pursued, but it's a hard problem.
The gentleman down here in the plaid shirt. Okay, and then you guys next.
Thank you. To pick up on that answer, do you have a sense in the general scheme of things of the relative impact of genetic mutations via the regulatory mechanisms that are not in the exome?
Yes, it's considerable. So I do think that there is a balance. I mean, I think we have good evidence that a lot of these hits that have come in common diseases are found in the intragenic, in that 99%. And the thinking there is, yes, there are certainly regulatory elements. I mean, we know parts of those, of that 99%, are parts of DNA that have been conserved for a long time. You know, we look at other organisms, it's there for a reason. You know, it's kept to be the same. I can't give you an answer of what percent, because I don't think we know yet, is a way to answer that. I don't think we've done enough sequencing of enough individuals to definitively answer you. But I think we have to keep going. The exome thing was a really good trick for us. We still do a lot of it, but you know, 5 years ago, that cost of a genome was $10,000. You know, I could do an exome for $1,000. So it's really been about efficiency, and it's probably become a little less important now because the delta is smaller. And certainly, if they were equal, which maybe someday they will be, you know, I'd rather sequence the whole genome to get the whole picture. So, you know, it's, I think it's, you know, it's a balancing act there.
Tom, I have three people. Yep.
Moderna has developed a messenger RNA vaccine for coronavirus, and I was wondering if that proves to work. Is that a form of template for attacking all viruses in the future, or is there something unique about the viruses that the messenger RNA wouldn't work on some?
I think you should have asked that question in the last seminar that was given here by Devin and Hardy's. I'm sorry, I really can't answer that question very well for you. I don't know.
You mentioned the number of 60 as the number of differences between your genome and your parents' genome. Is that due to mutations?
Yes.
And also, there are somatic mutations within yourself. So what is the rate of somatic mutations per division, and how do you, just in case your data isn't big enough, what about, I know, for example, tracking of cancers.
Yes.
You track the mutations. What about in less dramatic cases?
Yes.
And just in case your data isn't big enough yet, what about methylation and other epigenetic changes? Whoa. And you didn't say anything about the microbiome.
Wow. Okay.
And that will be the ninth talk in the no.
No, you really touched on every possible question there, haven't you? so let me back up. Yes, there. So 60, yes, those are de novo. Those are just for you. New mutation, that happens, certainly. That's one answer. There are certainly somatic mutations that don't have to do with cancer that are just in your blood from just age and being there. And those are now being detected more accurately as more sequencing is done more deeply. And there's some evidence that those somatic mutations in just in the blood, you know, correspond with some risk for disease. That tends to correlate with age. There's some data there that suggests that. We do go after the somatic mutations in the tumors. Tumors tend to have, what's the number? It varies by tumor, obviously, but thousands of somatic variants across the coding region that are different from the normal. That's often what we're trying to, you know, target when we're trying to find what might, you know, turn that tumor off or otherwise. But very important area. Methylation, yes, it's important. We haven't done a tremendous amount. I don't have a lot to say about that. I mean, it's obviously an important mechanism to turn genes on and off. And I do think as sort of genomics grows, I could certainly see us turning our eye more towards alternate assays like that. Yeah, you guys, I don't know.
So I have a question for Puneet. So you mentioned in one of the slides were the cardiac data, the deep learning system predicted a cardiac issue as more accurately as opposed to the doctor, right? So, I mean, isn't it equally important to understand how the deep learning system learned it and to retrain the doctor so that he or she can make the same prediction going forward? Or do you think that, you know, the system will get so complicated that, you know, we'll lose track of how it did it? I mean,
it's a really fantastic question. So we work very closely with cardiologists, and one of the things that we're always, it was important for us to be beholden to is there's a patient-physician interaction where the physician has to make a decision about what's going on with the patient in front of them. And just because the algorithm makes a prediction, it may not have all of the relevant data at that moment. And you need to figure out a way, we need to figure out a way to make those predictions explainable to the physician so they can continue to holistically treat the patient. So I think that's where a lot of the work is, that's where a lot of work is happening. This is saliency maps or explainability. How can you understand what the model has predicted and try to identify causes for why it believes that it's making those predictions? And then putting those in a clinical setting as a whole separate conversation. Doctors are extremely busy. They've got a lot going on. The last thing they need is some machine telling them to treat a patient slightly different than something they were already going to do. So I think there's a lot of real world challenges to taking models like this and putting them in a clinician setting for decision support. But we anticipate that there'll be value to figuring that out. And I think the question will be, how do we develop processes, softwares, tools that make that that process easy to do and reliable.
Question over here.
Thank you. This question is more about the data itself, so maybe for Danielle. I understand and appreciate why we use AWS, Azure, Google Cloud for active storage and access of data, but I'm curious about what frameworks you're using or are proposing to use for preservation and sustainability of those data to support continued reproducibility of analysis and machine learning models.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So that's a place where, you know, the raw cloud infrastructure won't support what science actually needs, right? And that's why software engineers and product managers and a diverse group of folks who've been kind of welcomed into institutes like the Broad to sort of help tackle these challenges are working on this night and day. But one example that I didn't speak too much about, but is sort of the web-facing platform for researchers called Terra. And basically, Terra is a collaboration among many groups, including the Broad. But what Terra aims to do is essentially make it easy for researchers to have a sandbox environment for them to analyze data, keep track of the tools they're using, the data they're using, version controls, and for it to respect the sort of security boundaries of the data that they're working in. But you can sort of think about it as like a scientific kind of Google Drive, where you can invite collaborators that are allowed to see the data, but it will respect kind of the privacy restrictions of what you're working on. But the idea of that is it's like now becomes the fundamental unit of reproducibility in science, right? And what we've seen is actually it's worked really well for scientific publications. So people can then flip the switch and turn that setting on that workspace from private to public and then link it in their publication, making it super easy for someone to open it, clone a version of it, and run the exact same analysis on their own data. But you're completely right. The public cloud vendors don't and aren't invested in sort of taking it that far, and that's where we come in.
We had a question come in from the internet. I'm guessing this is for you, Puneet. You mentioned the importance of connecting big data and machine learning to individual patient outcomes, but how much do antiquated medical record systems stymie the efforts to make that final connection? I almost didn't use the word antiquated, but I figured just go with what's here. And is anything being done about that?
It's a great question. I think there's a lot of advantage to getting a long history of patient data to help support some of these analyses. You want to see as far back as you can as you're making a prediction for why somebody may be having a disease, maybe suffering a disease. And the data is really messy. Electronic medical records are relatively new phenomena. They've been adopted at different paces. Physicians enter data in differently. Data is recorded with different units. So it's a really hard data harmonization problem. How can you get all the data looking the same way so you can build up these large cohorts? And I think the answer is we'll try to do the best we can, but not all of the data is going to be there. Some of it is going to be missing. A lot of the data is biased to begin with. When somebody shows up in a hospital, it's because they're sick. So you're not really getting a prospective study of what's happening there. So these are all hard problems to wrestle with, but there are tools out there, modern software tools. You require sometimes physicians to go in and actually look at the data and correct it for you to make sure your models are doing well. And tools like that will be adopted over time and help to make the data easier to use.
And I'll toss in one last question that came in from the internet. And this is again to you, Puneet. Basically asking, is there a way to use machine learning for things like looking at EKGs where you're not just necessarily learning something about survival, but you're actually learning about disease mechanisms? Can you pick up something that has to do with pathogenicity?
Yeah, so another great question. And I think, as I mentioned, it's early days, and we're all trying to ask these same questions. So there are ways of looking at an EKG which give you an idea of how the machine is thinking about the physiology of the patient, what might be there. And if we then want to take that and ask, how does this relate to disease, we can imagine doing a lot of the same things, and people are doing this, that Stacey talked about. You can look in a large collection of people that you have EKGs for and genomics, and you can see if there's interesting correlations between the two, which might then pinpoint a variant or a region on the genome that causes what you're seeing in the EKG. So it's an extremely active area of research that we're all pretty excited about.
And then I think we have time for one more here. And I'm going to throw this out to all of you. And it has to do with sort of the healthcare and insurance implications of the technologies and sequencing that we've all been talking about tonight. Does a previously undiagnosed condition become a pre-existing condition if you have a deterministic finding from sequencing as far as health insurance?
Well, there are.
Or should it?
Oh, should it? There are laws against, you know, discriminating based on genetic information right now. These GINA laws. So I understand, you know, as far as I understand, that those laws still exist. They're meaningful, but I do absolutely think these issues are going to be revisited over time, as more and more of us become sequenced, as more people send their DNA to 23andMe, and that DNA, that data gets shared. And so I do think that this is, will be a constantly, you know, evolving topic that, you know, hopefully doesn't scare people off from getting their DNA sequenced and contributing to research, because this is really, I think, for the good of the next sort of generation of discoveries, of medicines, of vaccines. And so I think that, you know, we as society are going to have to, you know, weigh those issues.
Well, thank you, Stacey. Thank you, Danielle. Thank you, Puneet. And thank you to all of you for joining us tonight.